Welcome to VTU eSectional program. This is the course Building Services 3, 18 ARC 63 for BARC 6th semester under VTU. And I am Dakshaini Patil, Associate Professor, BMS College of Architecture, Bull Temple Road, Bangalore. So we have commenced this course for the modules 1 and 2 dealing with mechanical ventilation and air conditioning. So prior to this lecture, we have completed understanding of the process of refrigeration, refrigerant applications, and also seen one of the types of refrigeration cycle, that is vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Okay, so moving ahead, this particular class we will look at the second type of refrigeration process or the refrigeration cycle, which is called as vapor absorption refrigeration cycle, VAR. The previous one was vapor compression refrigeration cycle, VCR. So to catch a recap of vapor compression refrigeration cycle, we saw it had four main components: evaporator, compressor, condenser, and throttling device. And the refrigerant was flowing in a cyclic manner, in a sequential manner, across the four components and undergoing change in its temperature, pressure, and change of state as well. So very systematically that process was achieved, and a cooling of the system happened. And I think I will just share a YouTube link here. You can go and see a very nicely well explained animated video and the process happening. But before I go to the next vapor absorption refrigeration cycle, one point I probably missed mentioning was the evaporator component in a VCR refrigeration cycle is the component in this entire setup which is directly in contact with the object or space to be cooled. That's why we called it the heat exchanger. So that is the component which is going to take the heat from the adjacent object or space, be it refrigeration or air conditioning. So always to remember, the evaporator is going to be a indirect adjunct contact with the space to be cooled. So you can take a look at this video for better visualization of the entire cycle, which we have discussed in the last class along with the diagram. Now we will go to the second type, the vapor absorption refrigeration cycle. So the only word different here is the absorption, whereas there it was compression. So that gives a clue that there is a change in that particular function which happened in VCR, that is a compression. So we have something called as absorption. Now we are going to see how it varies from the VCR cycle. So vapor absorption around 1820s by Michael Faraday. If you recollect, around the same time, a little earlier to this, was the vapor compression refrigeration cycle, and ammonia was the one of the initial refrigerant substances to be used, and the main intent then was creating ice. Okay. Further to that, lots of R&D happened, innovations seen, and the refrigeration industry has progressed by a multitude amount. And the point of contention we discussed was the use of refrigerants which are harming CFCs, which are harming the ozone layer, and the inventions happening to replace them with better, safer refrigerants. So all that we have seen, and we'll move ahead. So vapor absorption refrigeration cycle is basically a heat operated system. It uses heat source to provide energy to drive the cooling system. So we need to have a source of heat to actually run the system. And what is the principle this is based on? This is a very important fundamental principle for a VAR cycle. We will see that. The principle of some gases absorbed by certain other substances at some temperature and pressure. So it banks on a property of certain gases which have affinity or which get absorbed easily by other substances at a specific temperature and pressure. So pairs of these substances that have affinity for one another, such as, for example, table salt. You keep a bowl of table salt and very close to it you keep water. Eventually, it is going to start absorbing the water vapor from the water, and salt gets sticky or changes its crispness to becoming moist. So table salt has a definite affinity to absorb water vapor from air. You need not even just mix it with water, you just keep them close by close. It happens. So that is called as affinity for one another. So the vapor absorption refrigeration cycle is going to adopt this principle. We will see some examples. Ammonia and water, a combination of these, where ammonia is used as refrigerant and water is the absorber. They also have affinity to one another. Similarly, water and lithium bromide, where water becomes the refrigerant and lithium bromide becomes the absorber. So this is something different to what we saw in the vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Now, how does this work and what are the applications or its salient points we will be looking at? It is used in large AC systems and the compressor is definitely absent. That's why it is no more called a vapor compression cycle, rather it's a vapor absorption cycle. Hence, the advantage of less vibration, less noise and less weight than the VCR machine. The compressor was the heaviest part in the VCR cycle. So VAR has the advantage of being less noisy and reduced vibrations, reduced weight. Now compared to VCR cycle, VAR has a low coefficient of performance, about 1/5 of VCR. So essentially speaking, the performance output of a VAR is lesser than VCR, is about 1/5 of VCR cycle. But why is it then that we are adopting it? Because we can use a solar or thermal source to run this. Hence, it becomes useful or adaptable where electricity is unreliable. Either electricity is not easily available or it has various aspects of fluctuations or inconsistency, right? So that moment, solar or thermal source can be handy and VAR can be adopted. So in such places, normally you will notice VAR will be adopted. Now, except for the compression aspect, the other various processes are very similar to VCR. Expansion, condensation remain similar to what we saw in the VCR. So kindly revise the VCR cycle to understand those processes again. Now, difference between VCR and VAR briefly, apart from it using thermal and heat sources, it lies in the method employed to create two pressure levels for evaporation and condensation of refrigerant. So the method employed to achieve the pressure level differentiation for evaporation and condensation of refrigerant is varying here. We will see ahead. And the manner by which circulation of refrigerant in the system is achieved. So these two are two prime differences between VCR and VAR cycle. Now looking at the cycle a little in detail now. The compressor, we said the compressor is missing, but who takes care of that function? So compressor is replaced by a combination of absorber and generator. So compressor, that bulky heat exchanger or the machine of the VCR cycle, is replaced with absorber and generator. It's a combination of two. Now, a solution known as absorbent. A solution known as absorbent, which has high affinity for refrigerant used. So remember, there is that refrigeration as is in the VCR cycle. It is a fluid which is exchange medium for heat. It is running in the pipe in a cyclic manner. But we have added one more component or solution called as absorbent. Now this is chosen rightly in such a way that it has affinity for the refrigerant. So refrigerant is supposedly highly soluble in this absorbent. The suction function of the compressor is performed by the absorbent in the absorber. So what the compressor did there, compressing activity, is now performed by the absorbent in the absorber, and to assist, a generator is in place. So this generator performs the function of compression and discharge. So I hope this is a very important difference between VCR and VAR cycle. The process of compression is achieved in a varied manner here by using absorber and generator. The absorbent, which is in the absorber, has high affinity for the refrigerant like water, ammonia, water, lithium bromide. Okay, so the compression function is now performed by the absorbent solution and the generator. So you have a generator to perform that to take care of the energy aspect. Now, how is the refrigerant path in the VAR cycle? So it moves from evaporator to the absorber, generator, condenser, back to evaporator. So do you see that difference here? The compressor is now replaced by absorber and generator. So evaporator to absorber to the generator, condenser and evaporator. Cyclic path is followed. And what is the absorbent path? We have another solution here. So absorbent path is restricted between the absorber, generator and back to absorber. Now this is a diagrammatic sketch similar to what we saw for VCR. Now let me take you through. You have the evaporator, right? Then throttling device. So throttling device will begin from here. Evaporator, because the path is like that. Then we have the absorber. Then we have the vapor generator. In between, we will have the motor. So between the generator and the absorber, the absorbent path is seen. So NH3 is the absorbent that is used here. And the other line is for refrigerant. So kindly note this arrow. sorry, that arrow is the refrigerant path. This is the absorbent path. Okay, so evaporator, absorber, generator, and the paths, throttling device or the refrigerant control, correct? And we have the condenser here, evaporator, absorber, generator, condenser, throttling device. The main components, in between you have the suction line and all that, and also the absorbent, where the refrigerant mixes with the absorbent and then proceeds. But the absorbent has to come back to its reservoir. So that is the path here. Now I'll diagrammatically show how that is enabled. Also to note here, liquid state, low pressure, partly vapor liquid. Then it becomes completely vapor and back to liquid. The state of the refrigerant is similar to VCR. So now let us see. Now to the right we have the evaporator, to the left we have the absorber. Now let us see how that path of absorbent happens. Now see, the green is the evaporator. Okay, so it expands, evaporates. Absorber doing nothing at that stage. Then when evaporator has evaporated or expanded, because of the affinity, it gets absorbed by the absorbent in the absorbent, correct? The absorber in the absorbent pulls in the evaporator because of the affinity. It's a natural property of these two substances, affinity. So you see now the refrigerant and the absorbent mix. There is mixing, and then you come to the next stage. After that, the refrigerant is given back. Till then, it is like a reservoir. It has absorbed the refrigerant. But it again comes back and adds on to the same volume that you see here. So that is the how the process of absorption happens and coming back to state 1. Then it comes to here, absorbs and given back. It is like you are holding like a safe reservoir for the refrigerant when it expands into gas. So that gaseous material is absorbed by the absorbent, and further it gives it back in the liquid state. So that is the principle adopted in a vapor absorption cycle. I hope it's clear. Very interestingly, the paths are decided, and the way, the mode of getting back the evaporator from the gaseous state to liquid state is enabled. So now let us define or describe each step. Step 1, mix of ammonia. We are considering example of two components, refrigerant and the absorbent. So let us take the combination of ammonia and water. So mix of ammonia and water is pumped and heated. Thus, it increases in temperature and pressure of ammonia. So now ammonia, the refrigerant, leaves the absorber at high pressure and temperature. So we are witnessing what process here? Compression. Now the refrigerant enters the condenser where it is cooled by water. Remember now at this point, evaporator and condenser both have two sets of parallel coils, one in which the refrigerant flows and the other in which fluid flows. The fluid could be air or water, very right. Hence, condensers are always called as air-cooled condenser or water-cooled condenser. I will be asking this question when we come to air conditioning units. Now, this is a condenser which is cooled by water, so it is a water-cooled condenser. Refrigerant enters the condenser where it is cooled by water. Temperature and pressure reduces. The condensation process is witnessed here. Now, the refrigerant passes through the throttling device. Throttling device, what is the function? Right, it will control the amount of a refrigerant that has to flow into the evaporator. Temperature and pressure reduces further. The process of expansion is witnessed here. So, throttling device, not to be underestimated, it's a very important component as well in the refrigeration cycle. It is like a gate pass. The right amount of refrigerant has to move on to the evaporator from the reservoir. And simultaneously, there is a change in pressure and temperature. So, it reduces. Now, the refrigerant enters the evaporator where it produces the cooling effect. Now, my question again, where is the evaporator? It is very immediate contact with the object or space to be cooled. That is the point of entry of heat from the object or space into this entire system of refrigeration. So this is where cooling effect is enabled. So that is evaporation. Now it leaves the evaporator in vapor state as a gas. So this gas enters the absorber, where it is absorbed by the absorbent water and compressed by the pump. The process repeats and the cycle continues. So this is how the cyclic vapor absorption refrigeration cycle is enabled with the absorbent in place. So you can elaborate these steps and also explain the other processes in detail which we have done in vapor compression refrigeration cycle. So kindly go back, acquaint yourself there and understand how the deviation has happened here with respect to the compression process of the entire cycle. Okay, so that was about the two types of refrigeration cycles. We will glance at heat pump right now. What is the relevance of heat pump in this refrigeration industry? So the essential advantage of a heat pump is it can be used for both heating and cooling requirements. And most normally, it is a vapor compression refrigeration machine. It's nothing but that VCR machine that we have seen. So same thing, and very unlikely that it is a VAR. So heat pumps always synonymous with a vapor compression refrigeration cycle, and they have the advantage of heating in winter and cooling during summer times. As seen earlier in the VCR cycle, recollect the VCR cycle, heat is thrown out of a system or space to the outside, that is to the atmospheric air or body of water. Now referring to now the two circuits, air cooled, water cooled. So the heat of the system is most essentially, see, heat has to be removed from the system, you have to give it to somebody. So we removed the heat and gave it to either atmospheric air or body of water. Now, why should this heat that the system is giving out be wasted? That is the logic on which a heat pump was invented or introduced. So that heat which is given out of a refrigeration cycle via the condenser has to be used in some manner. So that was a novel idea with which a heat pump came up. And this heat can be heat pump, the heat could be used in various ways. Hence it is, and we said it is useful both for heating, cooling. So it implies that it is useful in both summer and winter times. By reversing, and how will you make it adaptable for both summer and winter? By reversing the direction of the refrigerant flow by using a reversing valve. So we have a thermostat or a reversing valve which will change the flow of the refrigerant during summer and winter. So in winter you want the heat to retain in the space. Revert the cycle and come back to the original to remove the heat from the space. So this is a simple schematic illustration of the same. Winter time, summer time. Let us begin with the summer time. Cool air given to the space, right? You see the arrow. The red arrow is the one where you're giving out the heat to the outside air. This is outside air. So from inside, red heat, the red line, heat is given out. Whereas what happens in winter, you get the heat back into the space and you give out the cooled air out to the outside. This is very essential in climatic zones where winters are really harsh. So you can also draw the schematic of the summer cooling, summer cycle cooling or winter cycle heating. See the arrows changing their direction, correct? Just glance at that. This evaporator is also called as room coil, only because it is the interface between the room and the system, and that is the point of heat entering the system. Now, cooling towers, the last component here. Cooling tower is the equipment that enables transfer of heat from the condenser water to the atmospheric air, while with the intent to reuse the water in a water-cooled condenser after cooling it. So essentially, heat, the heat pump and the cooling tower are with the objective of recycling the heat or the water. So when you have water cooled condenser, that water is going to be heated up and then it will be thrown out periodically. But why not cool the same water and recycle it? So that is the objective of cooling tower. So we have cooling towers which reduces the temperature of that particular water and it is reused in the process for a prolonged stretch of time. So that is the interesting aspect of refrigeration cycle, in the sense various innovations and steps taken to make it energy efficient. Use the heat output in better manner for running the system, or do not dispose of the heated water and keep on supplying cool water on the other end. Rather, recycle the same water by cooling it. So we have a cooling tower. And the energy consumption is found to be nominal or lower than otherwise. So these are some of the further links to watch animation of the entire concept of heating, ventilation, AC systems, HVAC systems, and the various components it has, gives a nice visualization on the working of the typical HVAC system. So you can watch this as a further add-on. There are various other resources also, but choosing the right time, which is explaining in the right manner, is essential. So, as an exercise, what I wish all of you do is determine the energy saving aspects related to refrigeration processes in buildings. So, as architects, we also bear that cost of adopting mechanical services towards being sustainable in the long run and energy saving. So you can do a add-on term paper or reading literature and happenings, case studies of some of the buildings where energy saving aspects related to refrigeration processes have been adopted. Secondly, you can also explore beyond what we saw already, the possibilities of environmentally safe processes and refrigerants. So that's also prerogative for any professional in the science or engineering arena. So these two would be the exercises for the section under refrigeration cycle. So we end the component, the module 1 with the aspect of refrigeration cycle here. In the next class, we will look at calculation of heating loads, cooling loads for designing a good AC system. So, thank you. See you ahead.